Hi, I'm Ellen Gerstein, and you're watching the Venom Vlog. I play Mrs. Manfredi in the Sony feature Venom that comes out October 5th, 2018. Right now, I'm playing a spunky character cherub in a comedic feature called Turnover. I'm also an independent filmmaker, and Seek was kind enough to put a link in his description box to one of my short films called Come Away With Me. Check it out. Thanks for watching. Enjoy the show.
Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome to the episode of Spitting Venom, aka the Venom Vlog, and today I am very excited for this episode because there is a current Venom comic that I actually liked all the way through. I had some minor nitpicks, as always. I am a critic, you know, when it comes to this kind of stuff, and I look at things from a writer and editing standpoint, and even from an art editing standpoint, I'll look at things. But this issue actually really surprised me. At the end of Mike Acosta's last Venom run, right before Donnie Cates took over, those last two issues kind of won me over, and I saw that he was able to make Eddie kind of a sympathetic character, show some of that dark humor, show him be heroic, and then also do the, you know, time-old tale of the symbiote reproducing and doing it in a way that I actually found semi-interesting. And so that's big. I give Mike Acosta a lot of credit for that because I was kind of 50-50 on his run the entire time, but those last two issues really pulled it in for me and really won me over. And so ever since then, I've been hoping he would come back to the Venomverse and write something with the character because he set up so many cool things in this world, especially with the Offspring and kind of, you know, Venom's new stance on things, a supporting cast of characters with Liz Allen and Dr. Steve, I believe his name is. And there's all these really great things in the book. And I love where he left off. And I was really hoping he would come back. And then early on, we saw rumors. We saw the thing on Amazon listing a, you know, a trade paperback for a book called Venom First Host, written by Mike Acosta and drawn by Mark Bagley. And so I was really giddy. I was like, oh man, if these guys come back for a miniseries or a second monthly book, I'll be so excited. And thank goodness that's exactly what happened, because here we are with Venom First Host, issue number 1 of 5. This is going to be a 5-issue miniseries, and I am, oh, it's really fun. This book really won me over. I read it twice, because there was a couple little things I was like, you know what, I don't know if I picked up on that. So I went back and reread it again, and the second time made me even like it more. This was a book, again, like I said, Donnie Cates I was super excited for, and Mike Acosta I was like, oh, it's okay that he's leaving the book because, you know, like I like his ending, but I hope those threads get picked up by, you know, Donnie Cates or a different writer. And then Donnie Cates stuff started to pull me away. And then so I was like, all right, well, this is, you know, like my last hope for a monthly Venom book, even if it's only a miniseries. This is my last hope for like really genuinely liking something through and through. So let's see if Mike Acosta can do it. And to me, he did. He really won me over in just the first page, because we talked about before how, you know, adding continuity sometimes can muddy the water. And what Donnie Cates is doing and some of the execution on it, I feel like he's, you know, adding continuity, but at the, you know, at the sake of retconning stuff, he's we're losing things, we're sacrificing stories like Eddie Brock's sister and other things. We're also introducing new powers like wings, which aren't really new. We've seen Venom with wings before. And we also seen Venom, you know, the symbiote do things like slow heart rates down and play dead and stuff. So to me, it's like, all right, none of these are really new and they're being sold as new. And but the idea of, you know, Null and all that stuff, even though I don't like Null specifically, his looks in particular, but the overall concept is neat. And I think it's a neat concept and it's a neat way to take Venom in that direction. And it's certainly working. A lot of you guys really love it. But for me, I'm just like, no, I like the street level stuff. I like the smaller stuff. And I like when it's not like the fate of the universe is at stake, but when it's like, you know, Eddie's soul is at stake. To me, those are some of the best stories. So this book actually introduces a new thing of continuity, which normally I would not like, and we talked about that before, but in this one, it's done in a way that actually still fits in to continuity, and they do it with one simple line of dialogue. So if you miss it, it seems out of place, and it makes you raise a bunch of questions. But rereading it and seeing that line and it really sinking in, I'm like, this is great. There is actually some real work put into this as far as adding this new part of the Venom lore. And what we do in this book is we don't even just talk about the first host being, because I thought it was going to be the symbiote Offspring that Venom had at the end of Mike Acosta's run. I thought it was going to be who's its first host. And I thought it was going to jump to different Marvel heroes, you know, and stuff like that. And it was like, oh, we're going to see a Venom Iron Fist. We're going to see a Venom Luke Cage or something and Daredevil. I thought it was going to be something like that, and I'm glad it's not. What it is actually talks a little bit about the offspring because it plays a part in the story, as we'll get to. But also in this, we get to see the first host of Venom itself, the suit that ends up on Eddie Brock before it made it to Battleworld, before it made it to Peter Parker and Deadpool, if you want to count that continuity. And I at first didn't like this. I was like, no, that's, you know, it's dumb. I don't like it. You know, the symbiote was an outcast. They said that in Planet of the Symbiotes, that it was different. It was had a you know, cognitive different, you know, outlook on things. It wasn't just there to feed and drain. It acted differently. So they labeled it as crazy and they sent it off somewhere. And to my surprise, and I don't know if Mike Acosta has ever watched our videos or if he just knew that, you know, from doing research on his own, but he actually includes that in this book. And for that reason, I love it. So before we dive into it, I'm going to give out the digital code. Boom, right there. Check that out. First person to put that code in, you get a copy of Venom First Host. So if you get it, let me know what you think of it down below. And now without further ado, let's dive in and I'll tell you exactly how much I really love this issue. First thing we have right off the bat, page one, you open it up and it has, you know, everything about Eddie. It kind of gives you the background on what's been going on. It doesn't take up a ton of room. It's very to the point. And then you have an actual image of Venom there, drawn by Mark Bagley. And I love it. It's simple. It's effective. And I like it way more than just like that, you know, Jonathan Hickman style, just like two-page spread. And it just says Venom, no artwork or nothing. You know, it's that's so boring and bland. They even reduce it to one page now in the recent Venom books. But I mean, come on. Include an image, man. It's just like, look at that. And you have, when you have a good artist like Ryan Stegman or Mark Bagley, like show them off on page one. Don't give us like the full black, you know, with just Venom written in red. I mean, that's, to me, that's just boring. But then we get this. And so we don't exactly know what planet we're on. We're led to assume it's Clintar, but it's not really Clintar. So what we have here is we have these two beings that are looking for something, and they talk about how, you know, like in the invaders have no word. The invaders have no word in their language for Eden, and so it kind of starts off, and you're like, oh, look at this beautiful place. And then it has this nice little like Marvel Comics Presents. It's like a movie kind of thing, and it's very cinematic, and I really like that. And then we get here. And we see this explorer picking up a symbiote. And it kind of seems a little Prometheus a little bit, you know, like from the movie Prometheus, but the stuff I liked in that movie. And where they go with this is great, because the one line of dialogue I'm referring to is says, this one appears to be some sort of outcast. We found it sequestered from the others, possibly cognitively damaged. Right there, one word bubble. They fit this event into continuity. So we get a timeline right off that one word bubble for hardcore fans. To new fans, it's just a line and it probably doesn't, you know, matter too much. But for me, this was the definitive moment in the comic of me liking it. I liked it right off the bat because of that line, because this showed me Mike Acosta has read previous Venom books and knew that the symbiote was an outcast. And was like, you know what, let's talk about that. Where was it outcast to? Did it go right to Battleworld? And the answer is no. What happens is it landed on this planet, it was found by this explorer, and it ended up on in the Kree-Skrull War, which is, again, if you want to take the Venom origin to a cosmic level and bring it to a new level and add all these cosmic elements, this was a neat way to do it, to tie it into Marvel continuity, not just making up, you know, this big, you know, vampire-looking dude that chops off heads of Celestials with symbiote swords that are, you know, that he had to forge in fire and, you know, hammer it, and that's why they're allergic to fire and sound waves or anything. It's nothing like that. To me, this was interesting, and it was, like, cool because it was like, oh, it's the Kree-Skrull War. That's not a place I would have figured this story to go. In a good way. And so we have one of the Skrulls, you know, he gets brought in and they're like, hey, kill all the Kree in here. And this Skrull guy's like, no. And he turns and kills the other Skrulls. And you find out he's actually in disguise and he's a Kree soldier that has this particular symbiote that was found, the outcast one. And so we have him here. His name is Tel Kar. And the artwork by Mark Bagley is amazing. It's very fun. It's very light. And you get introduced to this new character who is pretty much a hero. And he refused to kill his own. He was deep undercover. And he's like, you know what? I'm going to blow my cover because I am not going to kill a Kree, even though that's what's asked of me, so I can get to the root of this evil and give us the upper hand on this battle. I'm not going to do it at the sake and the sacrifice of my people, of the people of, you know, of where I'm from. And to me, this, like, in a metaphorical way, was like, this is great. He's adding to the continuity without sacrificing stuff. This is a hero who's doing something heroic without sacrificing something other than himself. And it's really great. That's what a hero should do. And it sets an example of the symbiote and maybe why it yearns to do good. And that ties into Mike Acosta's run where the suit did want to do more good than evil. And so this is awesome. And you see him there. He gives up the suit. He hands it over to another Kree person that he saved. And he's like, look, get it out of here. Give this to a general. Let it bond with them. They'll get all my memories. That's kind of how this thing works. And you know, use the memories I have, the knowledge I have from being on this ship and being like, you know, deep undercover, use that to turn the tides of this war and save our people. And so this guy's like, all right, no problem. And then as they're, you know, reaching the escape pods, the suit is like, no, I need to go back. I want to save him. I don't want Tel'Kar to die. And it jumps off of the Kree guy and the Kree leave without it. So whatever mission or, you know, answers it had, it never reached its destination. So we're led to presume, and I'm sure over the series of five issues they're going to talk about this, that the suit actually ends up on Battleworld from here, that somewhere it runs around the ship, and maybe the ship crash lands on Battleworld. We don't know, but it'll be interesting to see how the suit goes from here to Battleworld. But again, this is adding continuity, but not losing continuity to do so. And that's what I really like. And that to me shows, you know, the merits of, it shows the talent of a good writer. And it makes me really like this book again. So we're like 6-7 pages in, and I already am just like big smile on my face, loving every page as I turn it. From there, we go to a convenience store here, and we have Eddie Brock, and he's doing pretty much a scene that almost feels ripped right out of the movie. So I wonder if Mike Acosta got wind of something or saw one of the early trailers or something, or maybe it's just coincidence, but it has these two guys, robbing a convenience store. There's like an old guy working the counter, and there's a mom and her baby, you know, there while these two guys pull out guns and they're like, all right, give us all your money. And then Venom comes down, beats the crap out of both of them, and then comes right in to eat one of the guys. And then off panel, you see the woman crying and she's screaming. And then you hear Venom go crunch and you hear the guy screaming. There's no crunch, I guess, but you hear the guy screaming. And then the next scene is Venom sitting there with blood on his hands. So he killed this, you know, bad guy right in front of the mom, right in front of her child here, who's like, you know, crying and traumatized. And Venom turns back and says, you're a good mother. We can tell. Trust me, we're parents too. And he swings off with a big smile on his face. And it's like he just committed murder right in front of this young child and this mother. And he's just kind of like, hey, it's like this is the equivalent of him patting the woman on the head from Lethal Protector after he saved her from her purse being, you know, stolen. So this is again just showing that dark humor, showing humor at odd times. That's the big thing. Not even just dark humor, but just humor at the moments where you normally wouldn't put humor. And that's what makes Venom work. And then again, continuing that, you have Liz Allen's lab here at Alchemex, and you have him sitting here with the symbiote just on his head, and he's naked, just with his boxers, and bare, he's barefoot and everything. And he's in there, like the suit's playing with the offspring, and is, you know, trying to, you know, teach it things and show it things and show it how to maneuver and use its powers. And Liz is like, hey, can you please wear pants next time? And he's like, whatever, you know, like Eddie Brock just like has oblivious to him being, you know, weird right now. And that's, again, showing that humor. So Mike Acosta is very consistent in this book. And that's what I really loved, was that I didn't feel up and downs in this book. I just felt ups all the way. And it was delivered very well. I mean, there are, you know, your exposition pages and stuff, but they're very minimal. And then there's a point to it, too. There's real things in here that they're discussing that affect the characters. And it has Eddie making choices. That's the thing we talk about in Donny Cates' run. And again, I'm not trying to compare and say one writer is better than the other. These are just my opinions, but I'm just pointing out the differences and things, why I like some things and why I don't like other things. And then this for me is like the payoff here is that everything in this conversation is, you know, affects the characters, but it's also them making decisions. Eddie Brock finds out, you know, Liz is like, hey, I want to give you a contract to sign, and it has to do with this new, you know, offspring of yours. And he's like, yeah, what is this? And she's like, well, there's pharmaceutical applications of this baby symbiote. It produces certain chemicals that we can use to help people. And Eddie's like, yeah, but it's too soon. Like, what if those chemicals change? What if you inject them in something and they change or alter the person? Like, you're getting dangerous here, and you're showing me that you're not as good of a person as I thought. And this is not what I signed up for. We were just supposed to nurture the kid, make sure no one, you know, bad joins with it, and then eventually find someone who, you know, it can belong to. And that was our goal. That was our original plan. And you said that was okay. Why are you changing the deal on me? And so you see them, you know, getting into arguments, and you see Eddie making a stance on something and having an opinion on something and something that's going to alter the story, because he even threatens, you know, Liz here and says, look, so it looks like you showed me your teeth with this contract, but if you keep pushing me on this, I'm going to show you my teeth. And you can kind of see that Eddie is not having it. He doesn't like Liz's plan. And again, it just shows character, you know, development. It shows Eddie taking a stand, you know, being active in his own story and not just being told things. He's reacting to it and not handling it well, and he's threatening, and he has honest reactions to things, and it's just like, man, I want more of this. Like, this is great writing, in my opinion, and it keeps it fun and light at the same time. So then Eddie realizes he's being followed. He confronts the person who's following him, and it turns out he got the person wrong. It wasn't this guy, but it was someone who was shapeshift to look like him. And they electrocute Eddie, and they reveal themselves to be a Skrull, maybe even a Super Skrull. And I think this could be Lijah. I can't remember. There was a woman in Fantastic Four named Lijah who had like a similar headband, I think. Different costume, though, I think. But I don't know if this is Lijah or not. That would be cool if they did tie that in. But for all I know, it just could be just a random Skrull queen or warrior. So you guys let me know if you know who this is. But I thought maybe it could be Lijah from Fantastic Four. And after that, Eddie's out. You know, he gets electrocuted, he's down. But then she gets hit with a sewer lid in the back of the head, and she turns and she's like, what? Who's that? Who's that? And then that's when we reveal, boom. So that was Venom First Host by Mike Acosta and Mark Bagley. Please go pick this up. Even if you made it through my whole video and saw all the spoilers, please go pick it up. Support comic books on any level that you can. Financially, you know, if you're out there pirating stuff, please don't do that. You know, I know it's hard. I know a lot of us are broke. If you saw my Instagram account post the other day, you saw that I had like $3.26 in my bank account, which is still true this morning as I'm recording this video. That $3 is still in there. And, you know, I know times are tough for a lot of us, but if you can, you know, please spend money on comics, because, you know, we need these books to stick around. When stuff like this comes out, or the Donny Cates stuff like that, even though I'm not a big fan of the Donny Cates stuff, I still do like where it's going. I'm intrigued, at least, and I want that book to succeed. I want that book to continue, because I want Venom books to go past issue 50 without being renumbered or anything like that. I want to see the distance with a character like Venom. I want to see something really, you know, go long term with the character, because I think he can handle it, and I think it's his time. I mean, we had the Flash Thompson Venom run, which was amazing, that ran like 42 or 43 issues, maybe somewhere around there, but it would be great to see an Eddie Brock Venom book actually make it to issue 50 without a renumbering. That would be awesome. And in the meantime, hopefully Mike Acosta and Mark Bagley show up like once or twice a year to do a mini series with Venom, because I think they make a great team. And I think Mike Acosta's finally found his voice on Venom. He's figured out how to balance like the humor and the seriousness and, you know, the fun. I mean, he really does a great job. And those last two issues of his run just really sold me on him. And I'm glad he's back, and I'm glad he brought Bagley with him. So if you have a different opinion, let me know. Or if you have the same opinion, let me know down below, whichever one. And if you have made it through, like I said, even if you watched all my spoilers, it's still worth your money. Go pick this up and get ready for the next four issues that are coming out. Make sure you buy those as well. Support your local comic stores. And if you can't get to one, pick them up on Comixology or wherever online. Get a subscription like I did. Whatever you can do to get these books delivered to you, because they're worth it. And you know, as Venom fans, we should support it. You know, obviously, if you don't like it, that's one thing. That's fine. You don't have to support it for that reason. You know, but for those of you who are liking it, support it in that way. Support with your wallet, because that makes a difference and it matters. And if you can do that while also helping out a local business like a comic store, please do that as well. Anyway, that's going to be it for this episode. I know I talked long enough. I just had to gush about this book because I got really excited. That first line was so good that it just made me locked in for the rest of the issue. And so much so that after I finished it, I went away for a couple hours to work, came back home, and reread it again immediately because it was sitting with me all day. So having it now and talking about it while it's fresh in my mind to you guys was a lot of fun. So hopefully you enjoyed this video. And if you do, let me know. Thanks for watching my show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff. See you in the future. Peace.